Good morning. I'm Heather McLean. I use she, her pronouns, and I'm a member of our board of directors. Welcome to White Bear Unitarian Universalist Church. We are a community of youth, adults, and children of many diverse theologies held together by covenant, not creed. Together, we share the values of courage, reverence, and compassion. May you know deep welcome and belonging in this place. To share a request for today's meditation, please place it in the chat box before the opening hymn or add it to our meditation bowl. Please gain consent before you use someone's full name. The meditation bowl is in the Soul Work Center, along with some activities to help people of all ages engage with today's service. Welcome to our church. Together we grow our souls and serve the world in love.
I'm Reverend Jessica, and my pronouns are she, her. Before we do our call to worship, we have a couple of announcements this morning. We want to welcome our visitors, and this building has lived through many different iterations, right? So you might be visiting and hear about something, or you might be a member and still be like, I keep hearing about this Wheatley room, where is it? Or the DeYoung room, where is it? Well, today is your day. Every day is your day. But today is your day, because after the service, there is a brief 12-minute intro and tour. So who's doing the tour? Look for a sign. Yes, thank you. Look for a sign right over here. And tell me, I'm sorry, your name. Diane will be doing the tour. Thank you, Diane. Diane will be doing the tour. Look for her over by the fabric wall, and it will be 12 minutes. So you can go on about your day after that. But if, especially if you're visiting and you want to know a little bit more about us and get a tour of the building, please join Diane over there. And the tour will end in the social hall, where we are inviting you all. Everyone is invited to join in our conversation circles during the month of February. So these are a small group setting where you're invited to introduce yourself and then share a small sparklet that you're taking with you from today's service. So you're invited to do that this whole month after each service. This Wednesday, you're invited to join us for supper at 5:30, followed by our all ages soul work for everyone from ages 5 to 100. I'm gonna stretch it to 101. Come and be prepared to engage with our monthly theme and bring a playful spirit, or just bring your spirit. All are welcome. And then a couple of calendar markings that you can put on your calendar for the next few months. Thursday, February 29th is Leap Day. So join us for a Vespers that evening at 6:30 called A Meditation on Time. And so Jack and I will be leading that. And then on Thursday, March 21st, we'll be hosting a spring equinox service, much like our winter solstice service. And we're hoping to both incorporate a potluck beforehand and a bonfire with s'mores and a sing-along afterwards. So please contact Reverend Jack if you're willing to help make either of those before or after food-related events happen. Who doesn't love a s'more? I love a s'more. So those are our announcements, and I just want to name for those of you who may have come in this morning and heard a little bit of disquiet in the atrium when you came in. Our first service was disrupted this morning by a member who was having a mental health crisis. And so we did have a plan in place, and we responded with love and singing, and until the member left the sanctuary. And so we are going to be sending an email out, the board and staff will be sending an email out later today to give more details into that, but I just want to name that that's in the air this morning, and it was really heartbreaking for all involved, and also very triggering for those with their own histories of themselves or having family members who have mental health crises. So we're just holding this member and their family in deep care today. Now our call to worship from Reverend Rebecca Edmonston Lang. Come in. Come into this place which we make holy by our presence. Come in with all your vulnerabilities and strengths, fears and anxieties, loves and hopes. For here you need not hide nor pretend, nor be anything other than who you are and who you are called to be. Come into this place where we can touch and be touched, heal and be healed, forgive and be forgiven. Come into this place where the ordinary is sanctified, the human is celebrated, the compassionate is expected. Come into this place. Together we make it a holy place.
Good morning. My name is Bjorn Peterson, and I use he, him, and they, them pronouns. After 25 years of working in, living in, studying, and writing about intentional community, community work, and community transformation, I have a confession to make. Sometimes I really hate community. Maybe not where you thought this was going, but truthfully, anything I can say about the power of community, a power that I believe in deeply, has to include the very real context that it can be so hard, so draining, and so messy. And as a deep introvert, Sometimes I can only handle so much community at a time, like two of you with a half hour in between and a day to recover. And yet, I have given my life to these things because I recognize that so much joy, depth, and capacity can only be found in the gathering of people beyond the few I see every day. Even in this simple learning of names, something I really struggle with because of my learning disabilities, I've seen in myself and so many others the power of being known, recognized, familiar. Even before we talk about the good work and big dreams that community empowers, it's worth remembering the power of choosing reverence as our posture toward one another, of using the name and pronouns offered us as an act of deep hospitality, a reflection of who we are beyond our labels. It was this practice of naming one another into existence and the community that comes from mutual recognition that moved me to write a poem called Hallowed Be Thy Name. Hallowed be thy name, the one you give yourself, the one you're asking me to call you, the one I know. Hallowed be thy name, the one proclaiming your species, your earthbound body, the sorting one we share, setting us as people among peoples. Hallowed be thy name, the one somebody's mother, maybe yours, gave you, the one you hear from your lover's lips, the one you don't. Hallowed be thy name when a stranger refuses to call you by it, when a friend refuses, when you've never heard it on human lips. Hallowed be thy name when it is put to death, changed by the gods, raised from the dead, erased from your future. Hallowed be thy name when no one around you pronounces it how it echoes in your heart, when you offer one you hope will sound like belonging, when you still feel unbelonged. Hallowed be thy name, the one you offer, and therefore the one my name calls me to use. Thy name be hallowed, be thy name. Today, let us light the chalice for the ways we create community through mutuality, hospitality, and the life and power we call forth when we choose one another. Please join me in our opening words. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Now join us as we sing together our hymn, Morning Has Broken, number 38 in your gray hymnal.
Thank you. Well, it's now time for the story. So if you're a person at any age who wants to come closer to hear that story and sit among us, please do. We do have some stuffies. They're not puppets, they're stuffies to complement today's story.
In the first service, Jack said puppets. I had to correct him. And then someone came up to me afterwards and said, you will have puppets for the story in the future.
I welcome that.
Welcome, everyone.
Our story today is based on the three questions written and illustrated by John Muth. There once was a boy slash egg named Nikolai, who sometimes felt uncertain about the right way to act.
I want to be a good person, but I don't always know the best way to do that.
Nikolai's friends understood and wanted to help him.
If only I could find the answers to the three questions, then I would always know what to do.
What three questions?
When is the best time to do things? Who's the most important one, and what's the right thing to do?
Nikolai's friends considered the three questions. First, Sonia the owl spoke.
Ooh, to know the best time to do things, one must plan in advance.
She howled. What do owls do?
Who?
She hoot. Hooted. Thank you.
Give a hoot.
Gogol, the monkey, who had been rooting through some leaves to find something good to eat, said,
you will know when to do things if you watch and pay close attention.
Then Pushkin, the dog, who was just dozing off, rolled over and said,
Roof!
You can't pay attention to everything yourself. You need a pack to keep watch and help you decide when to do things. For example, Gogol, a coconut's about to fall on your head.
Bonk. Nikolai thought for a moment. Then he asked his second question.
Who's the most important one?
Owl had the first answer.
Ooh, those that are closest to heaven.
And then he heard from Monkey, who was still stroking his bruised noggin.
Those who know how to help the sick.
And then the dog, growling, said,
Grr.
Those who make the rules.
Grr.
Nikolai thought some more, then he asked his third question.
What's the right thing to do?
The owl responded first.
Ooh, flying.
Then Gogol the monkey.
Having fun all the time.
Then Pushkin the dog.
Grr, fighting.
Nikolai thought for a long while. He loved his friends. He knew they were all trying their best to help him answer the questions, but their answers didn't seem quite right. Then an idea came to him. I know, he thought. I will ask Leo the turtle. He has lived a very long time. Surely he will know the answers I am looking for. So Nikolai hiked high up into the mountains where the old turtle lived alone. When Nikolai arrived back to the new place that is the mountaintop, he found Leo digging in his garden. The turtle was old and digging was hard for him. So Nikolai asked,
I have three questions and I came to ask your help. When is the best time to do things? Who is the most important one? And what's the right thing to do?
Leo, the wise old turtle, listened carefully, but he only smiled. Then he went on with his digging.
You must be tired. Let me help you.
The old turtle gave him his shovel and thanked Nikolai. And because it was easier for a young egg to dig than it was for an old turtle, Nikolai kept digging until the rows were finished. But just as he finished, the wind blew wildly. Can I hear some wind sounds? And rain burst from darkened clouds. Can I hear some rain? Some thunder. As they moved toward the cottage for shelter, Nikolai suddenly heard a cry for help.
Caca!
Oh, that was the wrong animal. Fine.
Yep, it was. Running down the hill, he saw a panda in distress. The panda's leg had been injured by a fallen tree. Carefully, Nikolai carried her into Leo's house and made a splint for her leg with a stick of bamboo. The storm raged on. Can we hear it? Yeah. Banging at the doors and windows, Leo smiled when he saw what Nikolai had done. The next morning, the sun was warm, the storm had subsided, the birds sang, and all was well with the world. The panda's leg had been fixed, and she thanked Nikolai for saving her. At that moment, Nikolai's friends, Sonia, Gogol, and Pushkin, arrived to make sure everyone was all right. Nikolai felt great peace within himself. He had wonderful friends, and he had saved the panda. But he also felt disappointed. He still had not found the answers to his three questions. He also lost his place in the script. I think he just asks questions again, doesn't he? Oh, there we go. He asked Leo one more time. See, I knew. The old turtle looked at the boy and said,
"But your questions have been answered." You know, turtles talk real slow.
"They have?" asked Nikolai.
"Yesterday, if you had not stayed to help me dig my garden, you wouldn't have heard the panda's cries, caw-caw, for help in the storm. Therefore, the most important time you spent was digging in the garden. The most important one at the moment was me, and the most important thing to do was to help me with my garden. Later, when you found the injured panda, the most important time was the time you spent mending her leg. The most important one was the panda. And the most important thing to do was to take care of her and make her safe. Remember, then, there is only one important time, and that time is
now.
And there is only one important, oh, the most important one is the one you are
with.
And the most important thing is to do good for the one whom is by your side. For these, my dear Nikolai, are the answers to what is most important in the world."
And Sonia thought, "That is a better answer than flying." And Monkey thought, "That is a better answer than just having fun all the time." And Pushkin thought, "That probably is a better answer than fighting."
Pushkin had a southern accent. I just want to say that's okay.
The end. Let's sing our children and youth out to their classes. Let's pause for a moment of prayer and meditation. Gathered as we are together here, about 120 people in the room and 37 households on Zoom. As we consider together our pivot from last month's theme of liberating love to this month's theme of justice, we pause for a moment, finding a comfortable seat, becoming aware of your breath, breathing in peace and breathing out love. Letting your shoulders fall away from your ears in the warmth of this day. As we sink deeper into the reality of this moment, may we consider ourselves beloved. Beloved by ourselves, by each other, and by a force bigger than ourselves, whatever name we give to that force. Spirit of life, love, mystery, and wonder, we name ourselves today as products of fierce love, recipients of fierce love, and givers of fierce love. From that place, we settle into our state of belovedness. Amidst all our insecurities and worries, fears and doubts, we rest in the love that never lets us go. From that groundedness, we send out more love to those in our immediate circles, maybe even those who we are sharing this exact moment in space and time with. We think of the concentric circles spreading out from each of us individually, our sisters and brothers and siblings, parents, children, and those we share resident with, our inner circles, those we work with and our neighbors at the restaurant, at the park, on the road, in our cities, our state, our country, our neighbors and fellow pilgrims on this precious pale blue dot. We breathe in peace and breathe out love. Once we feel the depth of this love, we are able to disperse it far and wide. This morning we hold in the lights of love's embrace Barbara Warren and her husband Ron Crum as they celebrate the news that Ron's cancer is in remission. From Ellen Lowry, a prayer request for her sister and her sister's husband David as they recover from recent illness and prepare for David's pacemaker replacement surgery tomorrow at Regents Hospital. Celebration for the birth of second Emily's second child, and the birth of a 9-pound baby boy named Walter Henry, grandson of Carol Nelson. We also have a request, peace and love to my oldest sister, Dolores, who has entered hospice care. And now in the quietness and stillness of this place, we pause to name those we are holding in our thoughts and prayers, out loud, or silently in our hearts. We also pray for a member who disrupted the service this morning and all those who struggle with mental health. Knowing that love's embrace can hold this all, may it be so. Amen. Please remain seated and join me in Come, Come, Whoever You Are, and join me in the descant if you know it.
This is the moment in our service when we practice gratitude and support in the form of giving to our offering plate. The gifts collected today will go to support the mission of this congregation, to grow our souls and serve the world. There are a couple of ways you can give today. You can use the text to give feature. The number is in your order of service. You can give on the website, or you can place cash or a check in the offertory basket. Thank you for your generosity and your faith in this life that we live together. The offering will now be gratefully collected.
Our first reading this morning is titled, When the World as We Knew It Ended, a poem by Joy Harjo. We were dreaming on an occupied island at the farthest edge of a trembling nation when it went down. Two towers rose up from the East Island of Commerce and touched the sky. Men walked on the moon. Oil was sucked dry by two brothers. Then it went down, swallowed by a fire dragon, by oil and fear, eaten whole. It was coming. We had been watching since the eve of the missionaries in their long and solemn clothes to see what would happen. We saw it from the kitchen window over the sink as we made coffee, cooked rice, and potatoes, enough for an army. We saw it all as we changed diapers and fed the babies. We saw it through the branches of the knowledgeable tree, through the snags of stars, through the sun and storms, from our knees as we bathed and washed the floors. The conference of the birds warned us as they flew over destroyers in the harbor, parked there since the first takeover. It was by their song and talk we knew when to rise, when to look out the window to the commotion going on, the magnetic field thrown off by grief. We heard it, the racket in every corner of the world, as the hunger for war rose up in those who would steal to be president, to be king or emperor, to own the trees, stones, and everything else that moved about the earth, inside the earth, and above it. We knew it was coming, tasted the winds who gathered intelligence from each leaf and flower, from every mountain, sea, and desert, from every prayer and song all over this tiny universe floating in the skies of infinite being. And then it was over. This world we had grown to love for its sweet grasses, for the many colored horses and fishes, for the shimmering possibilities while dreaming. But then there were the seeds to plant and the babies who needed milk and comforting. And someone picked up a guitar or ukulele from the rubble and began to sing about the light flutter, the kick beneath the skin of the earth we felt there. Beneath us, a warm animal, a song being born between the legs of her, a poem. The second reading is a poem titled Shaking the Tree by Jean Lohman. Vine and branch were connected in this world of sound and echo, figure and shadow, the leaves contingent, roots pushing against earth. An apple belongs to itself, to stem and tree, to air that claims it, then ground. Connections balance, each motion changes another. Precarious, hanging together, we don't know what our lives support, and we touch in the least shift of breathing. Each holy thing is borrowed. Everything depends.
Thank you.
Many of you know that I grew up in California. I was raised in Southern California and the Bay Area, both of them, and spent time as a child at SeaWorld and Marine World Africa USA. Anyone in here been to either one of those? Marine World Africa USA was real big in the 90s. I'm pretty sure it's not in existence anymore. Both of them had whales and dolphins. This was before the time of the movie Blackfish, and it was right around the time of Free Willy. And as a child, before I knew how intelligent these animals were, I have so many memories of watching them in their huge tanks, feeling connected to them, feeling as if they had lessons for me. And what's true is, in this land of 10,000 lakes, dolphins still have lessons for us. So our sermon today is about dolphins. The lessons that they have for us is on how to be in community together. In the book Undrowned, Black Feminist Lessons from Marine Mammals, I highly recommend this book. It is not in our book stall, but it's called Undrowned, Black Feminist Lessons from Marine Mammals by Alexis Pauline Gums. She invites us to learn community lessons and collaboration from white-bellied, short-snouted dolphins, which you can see on your screens. She has five lessons that we can learn from these white-bellied, short-snouted dolphins that I'm going to share with you today. So the first lesson she invites us to remember from these dolphins is roll deep. These dolphins do not travel alone. These dolphins are in community, and they know that. They swim with whales and other dolphins to swim and eat in community. So lesson one is roll deep. Go towards community, and this community has so much going for it. We are officially at the 6-month mark of our first year together, half of a year of getting to know each other, figuring out who we are in this community, and planning for the future. And I came into ministry because of a love of people. People are beautiful, complicated, messy, broken, and whole, and we are better together than apart. And we are at an exciting time in this congregation. Your staff is preparing for our stewardship campaign in March, and we are bringing back the newsletter. That's right. Get excited. 9 o'clock was a little more excited. We're bringing back the newsletter. There we go. That's on the horizon. It will be in a different iteration than it was, but it's still a newsletter. So stay tuned. And we are exploring as a congregation how to show up for trans refugees and their families who are moving here from other states. And your social action committee is focusing on the subjects of housing and food insecurity this year. Our theme this month is justice, as Jack named, the practice of doing the next right thing. In my 6 months here, I have been learning about your history of showing up in the community, your history of doing the next right thing. This past week, I had an opportunity to tour the North Star Youth Drop-In Center at the Maplewood Mall. This center is run by the Tubman Center, but it was begun by congregants from right within this congregation. I'm pretty sure here right now. We have deep roots there and continue to collect items for them. Many of you have seen the cart in the social hall, and you might have wondered, what's that card doing there? What is North Star? Well, you could go and tour it anytime. And there is a list of items on the bulletin board in the hallway as well, if you're wondering what type of items they need. And as I toured this center, I was blown away by the amount of resources available to anyone who comes there. A place to rest, a place to take a pregnancy or an HIV test, a place for food, a place to wash up in the bathroom, all with dignity, privacy, and care. And they're expanding into the space next door. It really is an amazing project that we should be proud of. And I name this to remind you of the power of community, that power of community to show up and do the thing that needs to be done. This youth drop-in center is a perfect example of justice doing the next right thing. Alexis Pauline Gum's lesson number 2 from the dolphins is that they are better together. They travel in groups of hundreds, sometimes thousands, as you can see. They eat and sleep together. Community is needed for their existence. And so this congregation is, along with many others, is still in this forming and reforming after we're emerging from this pandemic that we're still living with. We're figuring out who we are together and how we want to show up in the world now. With a new lead minister, with people going on sabbaticals, with staff leaving and hiring of new staff, we are a community in process. And in the midst of uncertainty, personally and on a community level and on a national level, our invitation with this is to show up for each other. We are better together. The pandemic taught us this, and we learn each day that we show up for each other. And if you're looking for a way to show up for each other, our conversation circles that I mentioned at the beginning that are after the service today and all the services this month are a great way to practice this. Rabbi Sharon Bruce had a piece in the New York Times recently about the power of showing up for each other. She wrote, "Buried deep within the Mishnah, a Jewish legal compendium from around the 3rd century, is an ancient practice reflecting a deep understanding of the human psyche and spirit. When your heart is broken, when the specter of death visits your family, when you feel lost and inclined to retreat, you show up. You entrust your pain to the community." The text, Midot, chapter 2, verse 2, describes a pilgrimage ritual from the time of the Second Temple. Several times each year, hundreds of thousands of Jews would ascend to Jerusalem, the center of Jewish religious and political life. They would climb the steps to the Temple Mount and enter its enormous plaza and turn to the right, all circling counterclockwise. Meanwhile, the brokenhearted, the mourners, the lonely, the sick would make the same ritual, go up the Temple Mount, but they would turn to the left and circle in a clockwise direction, every step against the current. And each person who encountered someone in pain would look into the other person's eyes and inquire, "What happened to you? Why does your heart ache?" "My father died," a person might say. "There are so many things I never got to say to him." Or perhaps, "My partner left. I was completely blindsided." Or, "My child is sick. We're awaiting the test results." Those who walked from the right would offer a blessing, such as, "May the Holy One comfort you," they would say, or, "You are not alone." And then they would continue to walk until the next person was approached. Or until the next person approached. This practice of showing up, this story from this ancient Jewish scripture, tells us of the power of bearing witness to each other. It strengthens us to show up for the world. It strengthens us to bear witness, to learn how to carry the griefs and traumas of what it means to be alive. And the more we show up for each other, the more that we encourage each other to be our authentic selves within this community, to be vulnerable, to open our hearts to each other. And we don't show up to fix each other. We show up to listen and to bear witness. Lesson number 3 from those dolphins, they still have lessons, is that we can be seen on our own terms. These white-bellied, short-snouted dolphins were not spotted until 1971. But they existed long before that. And then in 1971, all these events coalesced to bring them into people's awareness. Maybe for some of you, this is part of your story within this congregation, within this faith, that you did not feel seen until you came to this place. I did not come out of the closet as bisexual, then queer, until I was 31 and belonged to a UU congregation. It gave me the strength and community and non-judgment to move more fully into naming my own identity. And this is what we do for each other, but we have to show up first. show up, and hold each other in covenant. Part of what makes this community, this faith, this life, this faith so life-changing is demonstrated in the power of presence. This worship would still be worship if there was only one of you here. But it wouldn't be that great, let me tell you. And there would have been a lot of pressure to laugh during that story that Jack and I led. And I've preached to a group of 9 people. That's the smallest that I've preached to before. It was small but mighty. But you all know that there is a power to showing up. There's power to being in this room surrounded by other people on this journey. And for many, this is how God shows up in people. One of my invitations to you today is to keep showing up. And so thank you to those of you who made the effort to come to this place today. And please keep doing so. And if you're on the fence about it, please keep showing up. We need you. I met with a congregant this week who said her New Year's resolution was to attend worship every Sunday. I realized, I know some of you were like, whoa, that's a lot. I realize this isn't possible for all of you, but for those of you who can make the effort, I encourage you to. And I encourage you not to just show up for yourself, but because the community is better because you are here. Not everyone is coming to see me or Jack or the choir or our guest musicians. Some people come to this place just to be in the room with you all and to know that they aren't alone. It makes a difference when you show up. And if the only way possible is for you to show up right now online to my people online, know that we see that and we honor it and look forward to the day when you are able to join us in person. Lesson number 4 from the dolphins is to do your depth work. The only requirement Alexis Pauline Gum says to be part of this massive oceanic family are that you have to be willing to dive deep. Because these dolphins, they eat 1,000 feet below the surface. The depth work is making a commitment to this congregation and continuing to show up. And when I talk about showing up, I mean not just sitting in the pews, I already did that ask, but I mean the ways that you're able to give to this congregation. I mean bringing food to the potlucks on Wednesday nights, being part of our cook teams, part of our greeters, serving in leadership or on committees, and the gift of your pledges. The staff and I have been going through the membership book, trying to discern what our membership looks like in 2024. And each year we do this. We go through the membership book because we recertify with the Unitarian Universalist Association. We talk about how many members there are, how many friends, how many children there are. We give them our budget numbers, and we talk about how we're using resources offered by the UUA. It's a whole process. So we're looking at our membership and what it looks like now. Some people think that they have been members because they signed the book 10 years ago. But if you haven't pledged in 10 years or 5 years or 2 years, chances are you're not actually counted as a member. It does say in our bylaws that a pledge of record is required for membership. Your pledge is one way that you show up for this community. And we have pledges in this community from $0 to $30,000. And whether your pledge is $0 or $5 or $30,000, the fact that you're making a pledge matters. Your pledge is just as important as the others. And when you fill out the pledge form each year, it means that you are committed to this congregation, that your family is committed to this congregation. And this is one more way of showing up for each other. This is part of that depth work. Digging deep to give in all the ways that you are able. And for those who aren't able, gratefully receiving the generosity of others who are. And we don't just show up for ourselves alone. We show up for this interconnected web of humanity, which extends beyond these walls. For that which we are a part, many of you have seen an ask in the recent e-news from Moose Jaw, the Minnesota UU Social Justice Alliance, asking for people from representatives from this congregation to help get out the vote, to work with them in anticipation of this presidential election this November. And How many people in here are having anxiety about that election? Because I certainly am. And my privilege says, just put your head under the pillow and pray it works out. But my faith tells me you actually have action to do. And so Moose Jaw is organizing a Get Out the Vote and UU the Vote activities in advance of this election. And I strongly hope there is energy in this congregation to get behind this, because our democracy is on the line this November. We need people to phone bank and write letters and to encourage others to vote with our shared values. This is one more way we can be generous with each other and practice justice making together. So our last lesson from our beautiful dolphins is to be ready to transform. They collectively change direction abruptly to keep humans from following them and will move thousands of miles to stay current with the ocean. To be in community means we are changed by it. I am changed by being one of your ministers, and you are changed by your relationships here. These mammals teach us what it means to be in community, that we are better together, we are responsible for each other. We can be a witness to each other, and together we are transformed, but it is an active, not a passive transformation. The power of community goes beyond words. It's in that place of transformation, of creation, of conflict in the source of transformation, of dreaming together about the world we want to create. That place of hope. We come to this place because we need hope, and the power of community is what inspires us to do that together. You all know that famous quote from Margaret Mead, "Never underestimate the power of a small group of committed people to change the world. In fact, it's the only thing that ever has." We have that power, dear ones, and we need all of you for this, and hope and love are at the center. Remember that we can show up together for things like the North Star Youth Drop-In Center, things like getting out the vote. These things can show us that we can make a difference. And if you are personally struggling and you have no energy for that, I hope that you found connection and people to bear witness to what you're carrying within this place. And if you are in a place of energy and resilience and have space to give, I hope that you are walking that opposite direction around the temple to bear witness to what others are carrying. Howard Zinn said, "To be hopeful in bad times is not just foolishly romantic. It's based on the fact that human history is a history not only of cruelty, but also of compassion, sacrifice, courage, and kindness." He continues, "What we choose to emphasize in this complex history will determine our lives. If we see only the worst, it destroys our capacity to do something. If we remember those times and places, and there are so many, where people have behaved magnificently, this gives us the energy to act, and at least the possibility of sending this spinning top of a world in a different direction. And if we do act in however small a way, we don't have to wait for some grand utopian future. The future is an infinite succession of presents, and to live now as we think human beings should live, in defiance of all that is bad around us, is itself a marvelous victory. And so may we roll deep together, recognize we are better together, be seen on our own terms, do our depth work, show up, and be ready to transform for hope, for each other, as if our lives depend on it, because they do. I am so glad and grateful to be on this journey with you all. Now the work begins. Amen. Please rise in body or spirit for our closing hymn, number 1020 in the teal hymnal, "Wo Yaya," and remain risen for our benediction.
Thank you.
Howard Zinn said, "The future is an infinite succession of presents. And to live now as we think human beings should live, in defiance of all that is bad around us, is itself a marvelous victory. May you center love and hope as you go from this place, as you greet each other and move out into your day and into your week. Amen and blessed be." Please join us in the social hall for conversation circles and coffee.